It's very exciting and quite an honor to be here as a peg leg alum myself and as a current parent. So I jumped at the invitation that Danielle gave me. And you probably have tiger moms and fathers, I'm guessing, it's nice. Parents who are always on you about your homework or to get better grades, to work harder, and so forth. And so it might surprise you if I tell you that this is the way we think about the way parents interact with their kids, that parents are always, that's supposed to be me and my two kids, parents influence kids, right? From the cradle all the way up through adulthood, the parents are transmitting their values, they're setting rules and boundaries, they're bonding with the kids, and they're shaping the kids not only through their genes, but also through their behavior, who they become. But it's actually not that simple, because I'm going to tell you today that actually kids affect their parents. Kids socialize, in a sense, raise their parents. And we know that the family is a bubbling cauldron of interactions. So how would we study this? How would a sociologist like to study this? Well, ideally, I would love to be a dictator. If I could just swap places with, say, Kim Jong-un and be in charge of the entire country, then I could answer all the questions I want to know. I'd do that because I would be able to randomly assign parents to kids and kids to parents. So I could take a really rebellious teenager and put them with that parent to see what happens. And I could take a very good student and put him with that parent to see what happens. And if I could do all that mixing it up, then I could know, just like a medical study that gives a placebo and a real pill, I could know, is that really a truly causal effect of the kid on the parent? Or is it the parents on the kid, or what's happening here? Obviously, we're not in North Korea, I'm not a dictator, so I can't do that. So there is one solution, however, that us social scientists use, and that is to look for something that's naturally random, that's naturally like assigning a treatment group and a control group, like you would in a medical trial. And in the US, that's child sex. So you get an X and a Y, or you get an X and X. In the United States, at least, there's not a lot of antenatal, prenatal sex selection, especially for the first kid. You get what you get, and you like what you get, as teachers like to say. So you can treat the birth of the first child as a boy or a girl as a random event that then we can study how does that affect parents. And you may say, that's crazy, like, that doesn't change a parent, it doesn't change them fundamentally, it doesn't tip them over one way or another if they have a boy or a girl. We love all our kids equally, we're not sexist in this country. Well, we studied that and we found that if you look at the you look at American parents and you look at how many, this is for parents with two children, and if you compare the parents that have zero daughters of the two, so they have two boys, this is one and one, and this is two girls. What do you notice? This is the proportion of parents that are Republican. If you have two boys, you're likely to be about 25 to 30% likelihood of being Republican. But if you have two girls, you're over 40%. Huge difference. I mean, if Hillary Clinton could get her hands on this, I don't know what you'd do with it, actually. Just target voter turnout for parents with boys, I guess. And even if you just look at the first child, if your first child is a son, then you're about 35% likely to be Republican. And if your first child's a daughter, you're about 42% likely to be a Republican. Of course, that would turn all elections in the United States. So what's driving this effect? Being a social scientist, kind of like being a detective. So we wanted to, my research assistant and I, Emily Rausch, who's now a professor herself at the University of Kansas, we wanted to dig deeper and find out what is this daughter effect or this son effect, we turn it around. What's driving it? So we looked at a bunch of attitudes, like attitudes towards women. We didn't find any effect on agreeing with the statement women should tend home, or that women should help their husband, or that we created an index of conservative views about women. None of these were affected by whether you had a son or a daughter. Then we thought, well, what about the hot-button topic in American politics, abortion. Abortion is actually, if you have a daughter, you're more likely to be supportive of abortion rights. That makes sense, right? If you have a daughter, you want her to be have her right to choose. Maybe if you have sons and you don't have a daughter, you don't really care as much. We found one that was very, so, but that wouldn't drive parents of daughters to be Republican, that would probably drive them to be Democratic, right? The one that was the biggest effect and swamped everything else was this. Parents of daughters thought that teen sex was always wrong. They basically became more conservative and wanted their daughters to be protected from the world of sexuality. And I'll come back to that at the end of the talk. So this might be interesting, this might be cute, how children's, in this case, their gender affects the parents, but maybe it doesn't have a lot of significance in the United States. My student, Abigail Weitzman, PhD student, looked in the developing world, in the what's now called the Global South, in poor countries where the gender relations are more fraught, the stakes are perhaps higher, and she looked at the effect of having a daughter or son in these countries. What did she find? She looked at domestic violence. If you have a daughter, the women in these surveys responded, 28% of the women in these surveys responded that they had experienced domestic violence. Oops. But only 22% of those that had a firstborn son responded that they had experienced domestic violence. That's a huge difference. Then she looked at another effect, and that is the effect of having a son on the dads. And she found that up until the kids are about age 12 or 13, until they hit puberty essentially, there's no effect on the dad's behavior of whether or not they have a daughter or a son firstborn. But once their son or daughter hits puberty, there's a huge effect. And what she found was that dads are either, they start behaving differently. Maybe they're trying to teach gender roles to their sons and by extension to their daughters. So they mimic certain behaviors so their sons will follow suit. Or maybe they're in competition with their sons. You know, they're married to their wife or partner and their sons are just starting to explore the world of dating and so forth or whatever happens in these countries. And the dads are jealous and they start acting out. Or maybe there's a different evolutionary strategy for parents, or dads in particular, when they have sons versus when they have daughters. Again, I'll come back to that. So what did she find? She found that whether or not, if you have a teenage son, the dads were more likely to have sex in the last 6 months. Or sorry, 4 weeks. They were less likely to use condoms. This is a huge issue in sub-Saharan Africa with transmission of AIDS. They were more likely to pay for sex in a last 6 month period. And they were more likely to have STDs as measured by, say, genital warts. I know this is a nice after lunch topic. In the United States, we find similar patterns, what she calls the second adolescence, that sons and daughters induce different responses. Now, in trying to put Republicans, domestic violence, and dad sexuality all together, what makes sense of this puzzle? And I'm going to argue that what makes sense of it all is evolution and what's called the Trivers-Willard hypothesis. Think about it. If you have a daughter, how many grandchildren is the maximum you can have if you just have a daughter? You probably can have about, if your daughter's really busy, maybe you could have 12 to 14. That's about it. That's almost the human limit. Natural fertility with no birth control or anything generally hovers around 7 to 8. But if you have a son, how many kids can you have? Noah's Ark, right? I think the world's record is in the 500s. King of Morocco from the Middle Ages. Now, but the problem is that we also observe that almost all women, this is at least historically, almost all women will have some offspring. But many men have zero. So in other words, especially in a competitive environment, many women want to mate with the male that's on the top of the hierarchy. We see this in humans, in baboons, in almost all animals. And so if you're at the top of the hierarchy, you could be like the king of Morocco and have 500 offspring. And that's good evolutionarily. But if you're at the bottom of the hierarchy, you're not going to have any kids. So sons are a riskier bet than daughters, right? So if you have a son, you might want a more freewheeling sexual marketplace, for lack of a better word, so that you encourage having more offspring. But if you have a daughter, you might want a more restrained or controlled sexual marketplace evolutionarily to regulate the number of kids that people are having in competition with your daughter. So that's all speculative. We don't know if evolution is what's driving this change in attitudes and politics in the United States and sexual behavior in sub-Saharan Africa and other places in the global south. But I hope you agree with me that it's not a one-way street. Parents are not just influencing their kids, giving them values, and changing them, that you guys are affecting us as well. Thank you.